There have been so many trailblazers in the struggle for equality and empowerment around the world. And Monica McWilliams has undoubtedly been one of them. Her legacy is amazing. And she's not finished yet. But the road ahead is tough. And there's so much to learn from those who led the way. That's why I'm privileged to be here in Belfast to learn from one of the best. Thank you so much for taking the time really to be with us today. I just want you to tell me a little bit about your early life and how it has shaped your passion for human rights, equality and justice.
Well, my early years were peaceful years, and for two reasons. One, I grew up on a farm inside a town. My father was a cattle dealer and my mother helped out there, and it was a beautiful experience, actually. We were five children and stepping stones, and we had the roaming of the fields, and running after the cattle and sheep taught me a lot about how to work as a team. And so I suppose once I got on my running feet, I never stopped. My father was a wise man. He wasn't educated. He had to leave school when he was 14 and to run a milk cart, and then started buying some cattle. But he taught me a lot as I worked in the fields with him. My mother was always saying in our house with five small children, keep the peace, keep the peace. And of course I was the rowdy one, probably. She had to say it to me more than anyone. Yeah. And I was very struck by the fact that the boys were allowed to do a lot more than the girls. And when we went to pick potatoes in the fields, the boys got paid twice as much as us girls. And I was only about 10, I started a bit of a strike about how the farmer shouldn't be doing that. Mm. And I suggested that the boys should stay at home one day and the girls should go alone and show and prove to him that we could do it just as well and deserved equal pay. Yeah. And of course the boys thought this was a daft idea, didn't take us up on it. But I must have been conscious of that the unfairness of that from a very early age. Mm-hmm. But there wasn't much mixing. That's another thing. We were a very segregated community in terms of religion. The Catholic girls went to the Catholic convent and we sat at the back of the bus. And the Protestant boys were at the Royal Academic Institute, the INST. And we hardly ever spoke to them or got to know them, which was very sad. We danced in different dance halls, played in different youth clubs, and had different sports.
Yeah.
So I was 18, I guess, when I got to really engage at university and found that there was no difference between us. That's why I'm very much in favour of children being educated together.
And how did that make you feel when you got to university and you felt, oh, I have a right and it doesn't have to be the same?
Yeah, well, I'd already realised it was a very imposed segregation and you didn't break the rules. And I was very keen to break those rules because I couldn't see any reason for them. And university was a huge liberation. I was becoming independent. I was studying subjects like anthropology, which was teaching me about other parts of the world, and I remember Melanesian islands in particular, and discovering women did things completely differently. I was very conscious of the world, and liberation theology had come in. Paulo Freire was writing a book on the pedagogy of the oppressed, which was about start where the people are. And it impressed me so much that you had to start at that level, from the grassroots, and think about literacy and numeracy, and any skills need to be where the people are at themselves, rather than talking down. So those were formative years, but they were also the worst years at university, because it was the height of the Troubles. And terrible things happened. I witnessed too many murders and was caught up in too many bombs. Some of whom, people that died, were good friends. One in particular was a student and had been tortured. and shot through the head 4 times, and his body was dumped on the near where we used to play in our student games. What struck me was the university's attitude towards us going, trying to do exams in the middle of chaos. It was as if nothing was happening outside its gates, which again taught me a lot about how people try to block out what's going on around them, which is not a good thing. Mm. It would have been much better if they had sat down and talked to us young students about the reality of the lives we were leading. At one stage, and during that strike in 74, we had no food, we had no electricity, we had no transport. We were boiling water and out on the street to make our tea. And suddenly, with the lights came on for half an hour, we'd rush to find what was in the cupboard. It was absolutely shocking. Mm-hmm. And this was in the United Kingdom's backyard, in the global north. Mm-hmm. It truly was a war at that time, and a very frightening one. And again, because of that tragedy, I couldn't wait to get out of it. And left and went to Michigan. I won a scholarship. And that was a different experience again, because I worked with African-American students. They saw me as the black person in the class. I was the only white person allowed to join the class because I was from Belfast. Right. And so the professor of urban planning and architecture said, this will be a good experience for you to come with us into Detroit. And that's where I cut my political teeth. They say you can go fast alone, but you can go further together. And I wanted to go with others together who had the same thinking as I had. And apartheid was at its height at that time. And we were in a campaign for nuclear disarmament because we could see the proliferation of arms, and nuclear arms in particular. And so that's where I put my efforts and energy into the anti-apartheid movement. And actually sitting in Detroit and Michigan, the University of Michigan, I would watch the news at night and actually plead to be able to come home. Because I felt that I had a choice. Many of the students there didn't, like the ones from South Africa were in exile. But I had a choice, and I thought, I've got the skills, I'm going home. And I could have stayed there and made my life, but I was desperate to come home and contribute. And I still feel that way today about people who have skills at whatever level can give of those skills, whether it's, you know, basic writing and asking people to do press releases or get involved in a campaign or raise the issues. So that's what we did around apartheid. We started picketing, actually, shops that were selling goods from South Africa, the oranges in particular, and the wine. And it wasn't very popular. People were really annoyed that we were doing this, but it really brought attention. Especially those brave shop workers in Dunn's in particular, who went on strike over it, who were suspended. So we lent our support and we raised money for them so that they could feed their families during that strike. And then we got to know some of the leaders in the apartheid movement and got mentored in many ways by some of those and stayed in touch with them. And that then brought me into the women's rights movement. I had been in the civil rights movement, and it was pretty male dominated, even though it was the women who were at the forefront of it, but nobody ever saw them. And no one today remembers their names. They got written out of history, but people remember the men's names, and they saw the photographs. And so that taught me that, you know, when women get organized, they need to also be respected for the roles of leadership that they play and not be seen as marginal to the movement. And so I threw my efforts into the women's rights movement. And that's where probably I learned more than anything.
Talking to you now, I feel you're one of my role models now. I just want to you to tell me, where did you have any role models or, you know, persons that inspired you to becoming, you know?
Of course, but they tended to be my friends. They tended to be strong women that I was working with. And I thought, if they can do it, I can do it. And that's a better model because it's closer to you. I always worry about people having role models because everyone has little weaknesses that people don't see.
Yeah.
And many of the people that were once my role models, I suddenly discovered things about them that I began to think, oh dear, it's true. There's nobody that has got perfection.
Exactly.
And so we have to live with imperfections and weaknesses. And
yeah.
But so I never set anybody up as on a pedestal, but I think it's lovely and thank you for that. It's lovely. And actually, I do agree with you. Women need role models.
They need
to see more women. Every time I see an all-male panel, as we call it, a manel, these days, I think, why didn't they put a woman in amongst them just as a role model to show other young women that they can do that job?
Yeah.
And so I agree with you, it's really important. But, and so for me, it was more about mentoring. And that word I wouldn't have known at that age in 20s and 30s. But it was really important that I found some who really helped me and assisted me in the work that I did with domestic violence. Mm. Like the organisation Women's Aid, there were amazing women in there who, there were no refuges when we started this work. And they squatted in an empty house and then found beds and found mattresses and then started a rota and kept minutes and records and putting in, you know, standards. That all was just basic grassroots work without a penny.
Yeah.
And running around pubs, rattling tin cans, looking for money. When you think of how far we've come today and those organisations are now seen as, you know, people with expertise and who need to be funded. But that wasn't the case when we started.
Yeah.
So, yeah, the role models for me at the time would have been probably President Mandela more than anybody because of the enormous strength of the man. And I was reading a lot about South Africa. And I love Africa. I love South Africa. And reading all of that struggle and the courage of the people. So I now say that I've met a lot of presidents and prime ministers and secretaries of state, and they wouldn't all be my role models. At the end of the day, it was the people close to home who were there at the start and are still with me today.
And were there any particular events or incidents that spurred you to become an activist and a campaigner?
Well, there were a lot. I was very young. At 15, I was on the civil rights marches. And that event on McGilligan Strand, when the army opened up with rubber bullets and CS gas, and my father was standing beside me and my friends were going down, falling down. One of them was hit with a rubber bullet and we could see the internment camp and the men on the roof, who had just been all lifted, some of them from my own town. And the injustice of that, the injustice of being on a peaceful march with sand and suddenly this oppressive techniques that were being used against us taught me that this is a complete injustice. So that event really made me think, this is not going to go well, this is not going to end well, because people are going to get angry. And today, you know, we're not fighting. But will this come a day when we've just gone out to march for our rights and it could end up in a completely different way? Mm-hmm. And it did. So that event really taught me a lot that you can put boots on the ground. You know, an army can come in.
But
there's a different way of solving problems than military means.
Yeah.
And you need to understand why people are rising up.
Human rights and justice is universal, of course. And do you think there are parallels in between your work here in Northern Ireland and around the world?
Yeah, absolutely. I quote Horatio, the Greek philosopher, saying, change the name and the story is told about you. And that was my experience when I went first to Bosnia and saw the bitterness that was there. And one person's grievance becomes another person's justice. I mean, it was just when people are driven that far apart, that's where human rights standards come in. And I had a difficult time here as the Chief Commissioner for Human Rights. I was mandated by the Good Friday Agreement with my fellow commissioners to draft the advice on a Bill of Rights, which is the most privileged thing that anyone could ever be asked to do. And it was a bit of a nightmare, to be honest, because people didn't understand what these standards were. And when I said that they also apply to women as well as to men, they went, no, that the war wasn't about that. The conflict wasn't about that. It was about Protestants and Catholics. And I said, look, we have got people coming into this country now who have no idea about Protestants and Catholics, who have rights. They're ethnic minorities, and we welcome the fact that they are coming in, and their rights are just as important as any rights based on religion or faith. Disability rights, the rights in terms of same-sex, gender rights, and in the end of the day, you provide a real safe country when you respect the other person's rights, even if you disagree with that person, that their rights are as important. And that's a battle that's still going on today. And we still don't have that Bill of Rights, nearly 25 years after the peace agreement. So what I learned was that actually decommissioning weapons, demobilizing armed groups, reintegrating prisoners, much easier than drafting a Bill of Rights. And so it taught me that the language of human rights, the culture of human rights, embedding a respect for human rights, the hardest thing of all.
What do you think were some of your highs and lows? And what insights did you take from them?
It's funny, you can always remember the lows. Well, the lows, of course, were the worst days of the Troubles. And I guess the high was the day that I signed the peace agreement. The high is also that my children could grow up in safety. Unlike us, as children, where my mother lay in bed every night wondering if we'd come home safely. And I did that too when the kids were young, but I didn't have to do that once the peace agreement started to bed down. The lows are the disappointments. I lost my seat when I was elected to the First Assembly. And the word they use when you lose your seat is eliminated. Elimination. And so I had a public announcement that I had just been eliminated. But there's an African proverb, fall down seven times, get up eight. And so I got up again and found another way of going on. And another disappointment would have been the fact that on the day that I presented the advice in the Bill of Rights, I was very proud of that day because we'd managed to do it, to complete it in our term of office. And it was International Human Rights Day on December 10th in 2008. And half of me was really delighted that we had succeeded in our task and handing it over. And half of me was absolutely knowing that once it went to 10 Downing Street and to the UK government, it would sit there gathering dust. And indeed it has. So that's a low that all these years. And I guess some of the highs were seeing the referendum, people voting for the peace agreement. One of the lows is voting to leave Europe in another referendum. So it's a roller coaster. And I guess that in my own home here, the day I came home from the peace agreement, my son had two small boys at the time, and the youngest one was skating on a skateboard outside on the street up and down, and I said, we made peace today, and he said, but aren't you supposed to do that every day? Big deal. And went on down the street. He probably didn't realise how important this thing was, that where we'd been fighting for 30 years, we'd finally made a deal. But I came in to the house and my older son was watching the news and saying, is it true? Is it true? We've got an agreement. It was Good Friday. And I said, yes. And he brought me down to earth very quickly by saying, so does that mean all the killing stops? And I said, no, it doesn't. We're having to still work on that. And will there be no more riots? No, it doesn't. And will I be able to, walk home safely from school, carrying his sports gear, which would have identified him. And I said, well, no, not really. You'll still have to be careful. He said, what did you sign today? And then I realised, but I knew it already, that it was just a piece of paper and that the hard work really started implementing it. And so my message to people now in Uganda and DRC in the Congo and Burkina Faso and Ethiopia, Mali and all of the places I travel to is that you need a lot of persistence, you need a lot of patience, and you need to keep at it. That 25 years after I became an oral signatory and said, yes, I do declare in favour of this agreement, that I'm still 25 years later working as hard as the day that I signed that piece of paper. So I guess it's a peace is an unfinished business, and like poverty, you know, it comes at you in different directions and how it breaks down, and you have to get up and fight it and find another way to come back at it, to make sure that, as I came back to those formative early years, that you're doing the right thing.
Yeah. And what do you think is the greatest barrier for equality?
Ignorance. People not experiencing it themselves, not having touched it, the lack of understanding, but also the lack of caring, coasting. I coasted along. Yeah, they're out there. It's them's. It doesn't really affect me. I think that to me that bothers me more than anything. And when I'm sitting in rooms with those conversations, I get sad, I get depressed, I get disappointed, I get angry. And I'm often, you know, the one that's thinking, am I the only one thinking like this? That I'm sitting here with a bunch of coasters who don't think any of this is really that important. And so why do I stay awake at night, or why do I sleep very well, by the way, but there are things that keep me awake and things that really bother me, and that bothers me. And that's why I have such admiration for concern, the very word itself. Probably that more than anything, the lack of concern.
And what can we do?
Everything. It's different strokes for different folks.
Yeah.
And I've been in I've done every part of the jobs, from working in women's aid, helping them, doing the policies, trying to write the changes to the laws, marching, going out, reclaiming the night, sitting in court cases, advocating for rape victims, befriending people, driving the bus when somebody needed to get a bit of a holiday for single parents, taking people out at short notice out of a dangerous situation. There's so many different things. And today it's mostly training that I'm doing, standing up and speaking out.
What are the biggest challenges facing women?
Well, I guess from my own experience and with the women I've worked with, it would be confidence. Not having it and watching other men probably telling you that, who are you to be talking? And obviously the misogynist attitudes that I faced was to take my self-esteem away when I did go into a public forum. And that happens to a lot of women when they enter public life, is to try and demean them and take their confidence. And it's really important that you don't let that happen. Cash. We don't have the resources. When I formed the Women's Coalition, we hadn't a penny. And when we actually asked others for it, we found that it wasn't women that had much money, but they gave what they could. But I had to go out and raise it. And so that's a hurdle, especially if you're going to form a big campaign or to go into political life as a woman. You don't have the same cash resources as your male comrades might have. The culture, I think that's a real issue, that it's not a done job for women to be in this role. For you to be a senior journalist, or for me to be a politician, or to be a university professor. Well, of course it is. and changing those attitudes. And I worked with domestic violence, so the culture there was terrible. You know, you had to put up with it. Keep the family together at all costs, instead of changing that culture and asking what cost. And the fourth one, which was closest to home when I had two small sons, was childcare. Who's going to mind the children? So you have no cash, you have very little confidence, the culture tells you it's not something you should be doing, and then you've got your children to mind, which is also part of the culture, because that's also about you really should be at home. And that was told to me in a public forum, go home and have babies. And I used to say that, you know, my brain is ticking here as much as any other part of my body. And the children, you know, need you as a mother. But you need to have either the backup of other people or creches or subsidised childcare or a community that's going to take care of those if you're going to be the person, you know, either leading or an organisation or in politics. So that's why women in that particular time of their life have a lot of energy, a lot of enthusiasm, a lot of passion, but actually can't do or apply it in the way that they would because they have these domestic responsibilities. So all four together probably are what keeps us in our place. But we have managed over the years to challenge them and get into a different space, and that's where women should stay.
I have a niece who is very passionate about human rights and equality. And what would be your advice to her in regards of like being an advocate and a campaigner like you to follow your footsteps?
Those are big terms, human rights and equality. So really she needs to sit down and think, right, which part am I most excited about, most passionate about? Is it violence against women? Is it sexual violations? Is it racism? Is it Islamophobia? What part of this can I most contribute to, and where are my skills? Who needs to listen to me and my experience and my voice? Today I work with Women's Aid. And I just see these amazing young women coming through who have talents like I would never have, in technology and all of the things that we now need to learn about in terms of the new forms of violations, but also how to promote our organisation. Is she a good writer? Is she a good researcher? Is she good at getting the fist of facts? Because everybody thinks that, you know, marching or campaigning, but sometimes it's getting the facts down that convinces other people that they thought they knew the answer when in fact here it is. So I don't know your niece well enough, but I would certainly be able to say to her, go and work in one of the organisations and see what they're doing and see if you actually fit in there. So wherever she's best fitted, and get a good friend for her, get a good mentor for her, because if she's got that passion, that's the best thing of all. I tell my own children, make sure that what you're doing is something you love. Don't make it a chore, don't make it, because you'll be disappointed. And even if there's not that much money in it, which often in the things that we're working in, there isn't. But you'll find the satisfaction in other ways. And for her, I guess, if she's got those words in her head, human rights and equality, because at the minute that might all be what it is, but wherever she's contributing, then start snowballing it.
Yeah, and of course, it's just not her. There's, of course, so many young people these days that really want to, you know, give back to the community and stand for the community. Mm. And they're very passionate about human rights, all those kind of, you know, gender, domestic violence and all of that.
Mm.
And they may not have the same influence like you have. But
she has energy. My sister and I were talking about that this morning, about what we were like when we were 20s and 30s and the energy that we had. And I don't have that anymore. I have to, you know, pace myself a bit more, slow down a bit more though. Some days I ask, and my sister says, it'd be good if you did more of it. But I said, wouldn't it be great to have those around you all the time? Because you feed off their energy. their enthusiasm, their innovation, their thinking, their creativity. They are ideas people. And when older people say to them, why not? They're all the time thinking of it. I hear it from my own sons, who are very much into climate change and pushing all the time the door further and further. So the thing she has is she's got capacity, she's got confidence, of course, passion, and most importantly, she's got energy.
Yeah, and what do you think is the impact of gender violence on our society?
Well, what I have seen in some of the countries I've worked is that they are getting a better grasp of it, both in terms of changing the thinking in the faith communities, both in the Islamic community in Uganda, where I worked, and I saw in the posters that were coming out based on the Quran, saying no, it did not say that women are subordinate, that men have to be dominant. And the same with the Catholic Church, who I have a huge population, and that's the way to get through, is straight from the church itself saying, no, this is wrong, this is unacceptable. Side by side, not one behind and the other in front, side by side. But the most important thing also is that I always said parity, like charity, starts in the home. And if you do not respect women in the home and girls in the home, then you are sending out a message very early on that their life is worth less. And that happens on the street. It then happens in the policy making world, in the government, and happens then amongst soldiers. So one of the best things I saw was the work that was being done with men in the DRC in particular. The men were sitting listening and the women were doing the talking. And the men weren't being judged. The women were saying, here's how we see it. And it was one of the best conversations. They talk about men's sheds here in this global north, but I've not seen this happening. And the same in displaced camps in Burma and Myanmar, where the new facilitators in domestic violence were talking with the men about the attitudinal thinking, about how they engage with women. And, you know, they're all on top of each other in those camps. Really important that that work is at that level. And so, you know, I've been at every level. You know, the protection work that I've been involved in, but also in the promotion work, which is the laws, changing the laws, but also the negotiations. And I've seen the power and the abusive power. And that's coercive control. I love this word that we finally got in to their heads, that we used to think it was gangsters and criminals that were coercively controlling their communities, which they are. But the coercive controller that can also be the policymaker or the lawyer or the government politician who doesn't want to make these changes because he benefits so much from them. And some women do too, and that's important that they also get to understand that they can't put other women down because somehow they made it on their own. So it does, it really does start in the home, but also it shouldn't just be there. It has to be in the schools, it has to be in the youth clubs, it has to be in the streets, the street theatres that I've seen in Africa, which are much better than any street theatres I've seen here. And likewise, right through to the policy level. But I do think in many ways, the countries that I have worked in, I want to lift the stuff and bring it back here. And why is it that they're much more open to this kind of thinking and these changes? I think it's probably because the women are so much stronger and are not told to, and sometimes they are, but like here, move over. You don't know what you're talking about, or shut up and sit down. So those are really important. So everything is interdependent. The language we use, the attitudes we have, the magazines we read, and the laws that we make, they're all completely intertwined.
And How can NGOs, like, for example, Concern, make a difference, do you think?
Investing in this kind of work, in showing that where women are at, you protect the children. If you protect the mother, you protect the child. And that's a simple message, but very hard for the courts to understand that, never mind a grassroots community. Showing the resilience and investing in that resilience, I think again, and the education is powerful, really important. And that, and I don't mean formal education in terms of classrooms and desks. I mean the investment where women are also able to be given trades and training to be independent. You know, the most important thing in my life was to have a little bit of money that I could call my own. Because that gave me a little bit of confidence, but also gave me a little bit of power that I couldn't be dictated to, either in terms of how I spent it or what I did with it. But I could invest and build on it. And that's what I see. And now, some of that's at a very micro level in Africa, but it makes a difference in India, Middle East. And to be able to open up that chest where there are treasures, and it mightn't be the treasures of Wall Street, but it's the treasures that make the difference in impoverished communities. And I think that's probably where Concern knows that. It has learnt that. It has seen the difference that that work makes. And it should be very proud of it.
Are you optimistic for the future?
Totally, completely. There are days when the glass is less than half full. But yes, I have to believe in myself. If I didn't believe in myself, I couldn't believe in others. And so I have to go on having that self-belief. But I'll always completely do it with others. And I've been fortunate that most of the things that I've worked in with others have turned out well.
What do you think really is the greatest challenge that the world is facing at the moment?
Probably climate change, which is impacting on poverty and drought and famine. Poverty has always been the greatest challenge, but also the tyranny, the autocratic leaders that seem to be climbing and getting support, that has been, you know, something that has woken us all up when we thought we'd left those years behind after the Second World War. So war and disease and climate change and tyranny, they're all intertwined. So those are the big challenges, but you know, they're not just global challenges, they're local challenges too, as we've discovered with the impact of COVID. And they haven't changed that much. I mean, except for climate change, we've been living with war for a long time, we've been living with poverty for a long time, we've been living with disease for quite some time until it came and hit us here in the global north. But I think the issue that's really waking people up is the time scale on climate change. We didn't put one on poverty, we didn't put one on war. But we're putting one on climate change, and a much-needed one. So it's good that people are now recognising even the wee small things that they're doing can contribute to that change. It's like Concern, it's the little £10 that contributes to the work that Concern wants to do. It's not the massive kind of big aid projects that are funded. It's that small piece that you can give, that I give, because I can afford to give it, and who can't? And that's easy to do, but it's so much needed in terms of fighting the issues that we've just been speaking about.
Is there any message that you'd like to convey to the, you know, the audience of Concern?
Well, I think the very title of Concern is a beautiful one. And the day that we lose Concern is the day we lose hope that we can make changes. And I've seen the work that Concern does, and I'm its biggest fan. And I love to be a diplomat for Concern, because I think Concern got it right. And, you know, it's organizations that have learned from the ground, and they have the ear of government. Now, what more can you say? Not many have that. And for me, that's where it's at. And that's why I want to work with organizations like Concern. I now have the time, and where I couldn't have done it as much as I could in the past.
Thank you so much. It's really been a privilege to talk to you. And I know that we're going to learn so much, and everybody's going to learn so much from your great experience and your time. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, Kevin. You're welcome.